Il Signore è mia luce e mia salvezza. Di chi avrò paura? Il Signore è difesa della mia vita. Di chi avrò timore? Ascolta, Signore, la mia voce. Io grido, abbi pietà di me, rispondimi. Di te ha detto il mio cuore. Cercate il suo volto. Il tuo volto, Signore, io cercherò.
St. Peter's Basilica is the home church of the Pope. That's well known. A lesser known fact is, however, that the foundational stone for this basilica was laid in 1506 to house a sacred veil that was brought here from Jerusalem. A veil with the face of Jesus. During the construction of the basilica, the veil vanished from St. Peter's and from Rome. But traces of this relic can still be found in this church, in this city, on this bridge, and in the entire world. But let's begin with this very bridge. This is the church of San Silvestro in Capite, in the heart of Rome. The title in Capite indicates that the severed head of St. John the Baptist is kept here, a prime relic of Christianity. But more important for the monks that lived here was a copy of the sacred veil with the face of Christ from the 3rd century, which was preserved here until the year 1870. This magnificent church is dedicated to Pope St. Sylvester, who had baptized Emperor Constantine the 4th century. It was given to the Benedictines, then to Greek monks, and bears a great history. In the year 1197, monks from Constantinople brought here a piece of the skull of St. John the Baptist. But as already mentioned, the skull is not the sole focus point, for here we find everywhere images of the veil. Very early on, and we do not exactly when, a copy of the veil had been fabricated in Edessa, Ufa in modern-day Turkey, and was brought to Rome. This copy is today closely guarded in the sacristy of the Sistine Chapel. The church, however, is still adorned with countless images that represent both the said veil and St. John's head. Both faces look similar. Jesus was related to John, and hence Jesus bore a facial resemblance to his cousin John the Baptist. The artists try to show that here. Desire and yearning to see the face of God runs like a golden thread through the entire Bible. On this trail, we travel now through the Abruzzi mountains to Monopello to see the sacred veil. From the very beginning, it was said that it was not made by human hands. It was out of sight and forgotten over centuries, but it had not been lost. What we will see in a few moments, emperors and popes longed to see, but never could, as we can see it now. We know today that this image is a miracle. It contains no color. It seems to be painted with light. It does not talk, and yet it speaks from the eternal word in Jesus Christ. It's a living image. There's no better reminder of God's mercy and his human face. That's where we're heading now. We do not know how the Volto Santo, as the Holy Veil is called at Montepello, really got here. It was in the middle of nowhere. What we do know today is that Montepello has become a destination for pilgrims from all over the world. We just heard a bus pulling in, full of pilgrims from Brazil. We do know that the Sacred Veil was brought here from Rome, and now we'll take a look at the place where it was first hidden. Here we see a plaque at one of the columns of the church, which recounts that 1638, the Volto Santo was given to the Capuchin monks. It is a little strange, however, that the veil was encased in this wall for 40 years, if it was a gift to the Capuchins. Why would it have been encased and hidden? How it got here is shrouded in mystery. Also the sacred veil itself, or the Sudarion from Jerusalem, as it had been called first, which we see on display here, is blanketed by mystery, rather like a meadow in summer is by butterflies. Although there are many uncertainties, some things about it are certain. There is the certainty of its existence. Then, that nobody can explain the inexplicable character of this absolutely unique object that contains a countless number of faces with the changes of light. It looks different to every person, African for an African, as Asian to an Asian. It has a virgin face. It appeals equally to men and women. It has had many names, but never changed its identity and very nature. Every pilgrim who has come to Montepello will add more observations as he or she gazes upon that holy face. Where we can see the Madonna here, there was a door with three locks and three keys. One key was held with the parish priest, one key with the mayor, and one key with the guardian in the Capuchin convent. Only all three of them at the same time could unlock the door and take out the veil. The rest of the time it was kept in this small tabernacle and was only taken out for an evening procession on August 6th, on the Feast of the Transfiguration of Christ. It was brought out of the main gate in the small church after the evening mass. They carried it down the Tarindi hill around the first corner and back. Later, a procession on the third Sunday of May was added to this tradition. Thus, it was only twice during the year that it came out to appear in public. This lasted up until 1948. Then it was decided that the veil would be taken out of the tabernacle and displayed outside here over the altar throughout the whole year. That is pretty much the state in which we see it today, with lamps which now illuminate it. In Rome, it had been the true treasure of the popes. Therefore, it was then planned in the year 1506 to be enclosed in the largest column of Christendom's largest basilica, the column having been built as an enormous safe to protect it. But it mysteriously disappeared from Rome during the sack of Rome in 1527 and was brought to and kept safe near a village named Sudarion, Sweatcloth, Manipal, Montepello for safekeeping. The Volto Santo of Montepello is nothing less than the Sudarion, the veil from the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem, where it had covered the face of Christ. This, of course, seems absolutely unbelievable. There is, however, No other theory which can compete with this assumption or any hypothesis what this image might otherwise be. This claim is supported by the fact of the unique material it was made out of. It is sea silk or byssus, also called gold of the seas. I've brought a little sample which might be able to explain it a little better in this light. Byssus is light active. It is this specific characteristic that means that when kept in the shade it remains brown, but once brought to the light it glitters golden. And it glitters like nothing else glitters, except maybe the burning bush in the days of Moses in the desert. You can see how it glitters. Here you see, in the sun it glitters and becomes the gold of the sea. In the shade it falls back into its brown tone. In the sun it glitters. In the shadow, it falls back to its brown tone. Moments ago, I explained how in this little basilica in Monopello we can find the Sudarion from Christ's tomb in Jerusalem. And there is no alternative to this truth if you consider and take the following six elements very seriously. The first is the Gospel of St. John of the resurrection of Christ. Secondly, if we take all objects connected to it seriously, as for instance the Shroud of Turin, the bloody cloth of Oviedo in Spain, the cloths in Cahors in France and in Kornelimünster in Germany, and this veil in Monopello. Thirdly, if we take seriously the structure of the tomb of Jerusalem, which has never changed. The tomb was destroyed, but it has been restored and retained its very structure. Fourthly and fifthly, if we take seriously the hour of the resurrection and the light of that hour. And finally and conclusively, the material of the veil, the sea silk or byssus and its photoactivity. And here I would like to recall briefly the story recorded in the Gospel of John. It says, at the beginning of the day at dawn, when it was still dark. That means it was shortly before sunrise in Jerusalem, since there dawns very quickly. First it is dark, then it is light. Then Mary Magdalene hastened to the tomb of Jesus, and she saw that it was open. She was scared. She did not say that he resurrected. That does not mean that she was less perceptive than the apostles. Anyway, she ran to them. At this point, the apostles most probably had gathered on Mount Zion in this upper room, where they had celebrated Holy Thursday with the Lord. Here they would later also experience Pentecost. And now she did not tell them he resurrected. She told them, the Lord has been taken away, and I do not know where he has been taken. The way from Mount Zion to the tomb takes maybe 15 minutes. The apostles were alarmed. John and Peter ran to the tomb, and John was faster. He bent down to look into the tomb, which means that the entrance was low. This tomb in Jerusalem faces east. It is a small chamber with a hallway left and a stone bench on the right-hand side. Onto this bench in the tomb, the dead Lord had been laid. So John bent down and looked into the tomb. It is very important to note that he did not enter the grave, since for pious Jews, some of the strictest laws were the laws of purity, and this is true for the past and for today. These laws shaped Judaism throughout history. No pork could be eaten and certain types of fish were forbidden. But the most unclean of all was anything that had to do with the tomb. So it was a natural timidity that kept John from entering. Pious Jews didn't enter graves. So John stopped and refrained from entering. Now Peter also reached the tomb, and for some reason he seemed not to have any timidity. That does not mean that he was any less of a Jew than John. He followed all laws equally, but he was the one who not even 40 hours beforehand had denied Jesus, saying, "I do not know this man." Then he had experience from afar that Jesus was crucified and killed. He could have well heard from a distance the last scream of Jesus. It was to Peter, though, that Jesus entrusted the first community. Peter had been the first who had recognized the Messiah in Jesus, who renamed him as Rock after that. He was supposed to be the foundation of the church. Now Peter was a man in shock. We cannot really emphasize enough his state of severe shock. In this state, Peter now entered the tomb. And here's something vitally important to be considered. For here we hear suddenly of cloths. In the Gospel of John, the tomb is not empty. It is loaded with cloth instead. The reason? In Jewish burials in those times, cloths were used in great abundance. There were multiple cloths and it was dark inside. You couldn't see anything, especially from the outside, with the exception of a little part from the floor right behind the entrance. Peter could basically just feel his way. He could feel that Jesus was not there anymore. But apart from this, the Gospel tells us here, there lay a sudarion, a veil that had lain on the face of Christ. Considering the structure of the tomb, there's only one possible position this expression is referring to, since the tomb and bench was ultimately not an unmade bed where a cloth could have disappeared to go unnoticed in a crack. Being apart could here only mean on the floor. Due to the angle, the floor was the only place where there, at this moment, was a little light from the outside. The sun was just rising. And now the first rays of the sun fell through the little entrance onto this spot. And there on the floor lay this little veil, and it was folded, we read. It was crumpled up somehow. It did not lie flat on the floor. It was not like a piece of paper. You could see something raised, uneven, and then Peter saw something like we have seen. He saw something sparkle, something glitter on the floor. Naturally, he picked it up, unfolded it. And obviously, he did not hold it up inside the tomb, but he held it against the light, against the sun. And then he saw what we have also seen today. He saw, he knew this man. He saw that Jesus lived. He saw this veil was not impure. He saw everything had changed. Then the Gospel goes on, where there is not one word too many or too few, that the other apostle entered and he saw and he believed. If he had entered and had seen an empty tomb only, then there would have been nothing to believe. It is not said of Mary Magdalene that she saw and she believed. It is only written that she had said, "They took the Lord away." That statement is a very natural kind of feeling. The different perceptions of Mary Magdalene, of Peter and John, were because of this veil made of byssus that radiated in the sunlight. That was the difference. Then both apostles were in the tomb and they knew all had changed. They knew they had to do one thing, since there was no time to lose. The tomb was guarded after all. They took everything. There were also other cloths and linen. The Shroud of Turin was surely among them, but within the tomb, they could not even stretch it out and look at it, since it was 4 meters long. The key, the crucial piece of cloth, was this small veil with the living face of Christ. The Holy Sudarion. In an instance, this had delivered the insight that everything had changed. Impurity did not exist anymore. Death had lost its power. They took everything and ran back to where they had come from. Then, a few lines later, there comes an important passage where it is written, on the same evening of the same day, Easter Sunday, Jesus stepped into their midst, stepping through the closed door that they are locked out of fear for the Jews, and breathed on them, Shalom, peace be with you. But the expression that they are locked the door out of fear of the Jews is very strange, since they were Jews themselves. They could have gone anywhere out of fear of the Jews. The fact that they remained in that room, however, and had locked the doors explains something quite clearly. They had something with them that invoked fear. If they had gone to the city center the next day and had told the people that Jesus had risen, the people would have thought, my dear, Jesus was taken from them, he was killed, now the poor men have gone crazy. But if the apostles had said, we have proofs, we've got something with us, we have something from the tomb, then you and I would not sit here. The church would not have been here, Christianity would not exist, the whole world would have been different. The Jewish culture would have been simply just unable to bear it. If the apostles had said that day, we have something from the tomb, the most unclean place, and it bears an image, which was against the second commandment. So this delicate veil broke at once with two major pillars of the Jewish culture of commandments and prohibitions. It was absolutely impossible to reveal its secret in that hour. They just could not have talked about it. That is the reason why John also many years later could only speak of the Sudarion, but not of the image, and that it had been saved from the empty tomb. So the day of the resurrection created a secret room within the church. It started with an arcanum, as it would have been later said in Latin, because this little veil, which has been so enigmatic throughout the centuries, was there. This little cloth, which has accompanied us through history and now speaks to us more than at any time in the past, is this very veil that we can see here in Manopello. In the past, it was simply impossible to recognize its inner meaning, because only today can we put together and read and disclose a countless number of elements like a puzzle, which previously had been dispersed throughout the world, in Turin, in Oviedo, in Cahors, Rome, Manopello, Jerusalem. Today, for the first time, we can see all of that in one picture as a first result of a digital revolution. Within that context, this true image arrives and comes back into history, now like a USB drive of God for the future, loaded with good news, which do not refute in any way any line or word of the Gospels. It summarizes the truth of the Gospel instead and brings it to a new level of information and understanding, not the least to the level of images in a true iconic turn and revolution.
Di chi avrò paura? Il Signore è difesa della mia vita. Di chi avrò timore? Ascolta, Signore, la mia voce. Io grido, abbi pietà di me, rispondimi. Di te ha detto il mio cuore. Cercate il suo volto.